You're listening to Little Rockers Radio, and today we are talking to someone who really doesn't need an introduction at all. We all know and love her, Noni Hazelhurst. Welcome, Noni. How are you?
Thanks, Sarah. Pretty good.
That's good. Now, massive congratulations on being inducted into the Logies Hall of Fame. How did that make you feel?
Well, when I first heard about it, I wasn't allowed to tell anyone, so it made me feel a bit sick, actually. No, look, it's a really lovely thing, and it really gives my family a lot of pleasure too. So, and when they, you know, look back and see all the things, I've forgotten half of them that I'd done. It's a lovely tribute, really lovely tribute to get it from your peers.
Yes, absolutely. And I have to say that your speech had me glued to the screen. I loved every bit of it and completely felt your passion. I'd like to ask if there's one major change or message that you'd like to see people take on board as a result of your speech, what would it be?
Really, I think, gosh, boil it down. Okay, I think really the key for me is that very small children who are preschool age, they are very pure and they're a blank canvas. And I think if we try to band-aid the things that we've got wrong after these kids start going to school, it's really difficult. You cannot put too much into a young child's life in terms of positive and or negative input. And so my plea really is to be aware how much negativity there is around and how difficult it is for small children, how difficult it is for all of us to cope with the amount of it, you know, the fact that it's everywhere. So if it gets us down, you know, a small child doesn't know that 9/11 didn't happen in the middle of Melbourne or Sydney or, you know, any of our cities unless someone tells them. And a lot of kids aren't in that position. I know that from a lot of the work I do with kids. You know, it's all very well saying, oh, well, the kids have ABC3. Well, you're either suggesting that little kids should watch television away from everybody else, or you're suggesting that little kids have the remote, and that often doesn't happen. So it's, really asking for consciousness of keeping at least that age group as protected as possible, because once they're at school, you know, there's so many other influences that you have no control over.
Yeah, that's so true, isn't it, that you completely have no control over, and it's about being aware, isn't it? If you're aware, then you can do so much more to help your children.
I know what it's like for parents. I've been one myself, and at the end of a long day and nearly everybody is working now if they're lucky, you know, even though you say, oh gosh, my kids are watching too much screens and I'm worried about it, most of us, when we're honest, will say, actually, I really need that peace for an hour at the end of the day or whatever it is. You know, it's actually sometimes easier to just let everybody retire hurt to their rooms, you know, and get into their social media for a bit of distraction rather than actually risk an argument with teenagers or whatever, whatever. So we all fall into the trap because we're all exhausted, and all we do there is just stop connecting with each other and feed more negativity into our heads and hearts, you know.
Now, moving on from that, Play School is turning 50 this year and continues to have a positive influence on both preschoolers and parents. You must be pleased to see that it still has such a strong connection with Australian families.
Well, look, if they don't tamper with it, there's no reason why it can't go on.
No.
Because it's so carefully crafted for that precious preschool age group. And parents instinctively know it, whether they experience it or not. They understand that the child here is getting exposure to a world that they can cope with and understand. So it does stand out as a sort of oasis. What saddens me is that it still is the standout, that there isn't more that caters specifically, not just for this age group, but that caters to our children a version of reality that actually bears some semblance of reality. You know, we've got kids growing up now who think reality equals The Bachelorette or equals the Kardashians or, you know, equals all these people who aren't very real. And even you know, the way people relate to you on television, even if they're just presenting, they're not very real. And so we're losing this heart-to-heart connection that we used to have from our families that were all around us, or our churches or clubs or whatever it was we once had time for, and allowing us ourselves to be spoken to and at rather than with.
Yes, and that I quite often say when I go back to how we were raised, or how our parents and our grandparents were raised, with that real sense of community around them. Everyone knew their neighbours, everyone was involved with either local clubs or churches or whatever it may have been.
Yeah,
but there was definitely, Now, I asked the Little Rockers Radio audience if they had any questions for you, and of course, no surprises, I had many come through. So I just wanted to read a couple out to you if I could. Kerry Hill wants to know, what play school host did you enjoy working with the most?
Look, we all got on very well, but my particular standout was John Hamblin, funny blonde English John, who really was the key to me understanding what I had to do. And that was primarily to drop my self-consciousness, which I first had. You know, I was more aware of the crew in the studio and looking like an idiot than I was concerned with focusing on that one child watching.
Yes.
And John was, you know, he was a bit of a maverick. You really shouldn't ad-lib very much. There's not room for it in play school. You've got to be very precise for all the camera cuts and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But John always managed to have that edge of danger that anything could happen because he was childlike.
Yes.
And, you know, and it was such a joy to actually for it to click that all I had to do was be enjoying the moment that we were creating, apart from remembering the lines and key and making the models. But essentially, if you just go with the flow and you know the framework, you've rehearsed it 5 times, even though there's no auto cue, you can relax and just enjoy having the imagined company of a small child.
Yeah.
And so he really had that magic, slight naughtiness, always ready for a giggle, the odd ad lib, you know, that kind of kept the parents in the loop but didn't alienate the child. But just sheer joy and fun, and that's what a child has, you know, a small child relates to because it's alive.
Yes, and he did do it so well. And a lot of people actually guessed that that's what your answer would be. People commented that John had you in fits of laughter, etc. So
yes,
not surprised.
Yes. Yes, I mean, at first I thought he was a bit naughty, you know, because he wouldn't necessarily know all the words of the songs, and I was such a little conch, you know. And, but I gradually started to relax and see that, you know, if you just launch, like anything, if you just launch yourself into it, hopefully you'll be able to problem solve most things that come your way, you know, and that's one of the philosophies of play school.
Yeah.
We used to tape it continuously like it was live. Now it's all broken up and it's a little bit more perfect, but when we did it, if you made a mistake, they wanted you to keep going so that you could model it, you could problem solve, and, you know, that it wasn't a terrible thing if your plans went astray. And so it was just one of those subtle things, but it was always part of the philosophy.
And a great philosophy too. The second question is from Saskia Petrobon, and I hope I've pronounced that correctly, Saskia. Now, she says, as a kindy teacher, I loved the beautiful, respectful way Noni talked about connection with children in her Logie speech, and connection with others is so important in life. This really resonated with me. And her question is, I would love to ask Noni to talk more about the connections she had or has with people who have influenced her life and career.
Ooh, that's a meaty one.
It is.
Look, everyone I've ever met has influenced my life and career. And I, in a way, I don't see my life as being separate from my career, because every character I play or every job that I'm lucky enough to be offered teaches me something about myself and about other people. And, you know, I just see life as one big learning experience. And some people influence you in a bad way or a negative way, and often we don't realise that, you know, for a long time. Or we put up with things because we think, oh, it's too hard, you know, I'll just go along and feel bad, but it's not as bad as I could feel, you know. We justify all kinds of decisions. But the people who influence me in my professional life are people who are who don't have an agenda that they're hiding, basically. And I guess it gets back to that real thing.
Yes.
If people are being genuine with me, just as a small child judges an adult, I can tell, and I'm interested if they're interested.
Yes.
But so many people, well, we all act. You know, every time you go out to a meeting or a shop or a school or somewhere, you're putting on a performance. You're behaving the way you think you should behave in that environment, hopefully. Mm-hmm. Acting isn't difficult. We all do it, whether it's conscious or unconscious, every time we are with someone. But being is really hard. And that's, again, why we go back to small children, because they have no trouble being whatsoever. But systematically, we work on them so that they be what we want them to be or not. And that's their choice, you know. So the thing that's, I think, I would love to see, I'd just love to see, you know, grandparents being able to communicate with their kids again instead of going, oh, hi, Grandma, and going off to the social media.
Yes.
You know, we're missing out on stories. We're missing out on connections all over the place.
Yeah, you're
because
right.
Because we're so tied to screens. Yeah, so, you know, I'm always influenced by whatever I see and hear. I don't know how I couldn't be. Maybe I'm just a bit, I don't know, maybe I'm oversensitive, but you sort of have to be a performer.
Yeah, well, you do. And I think, I think we're getting to that point with the bombardment of media and news and screens and everything where that is becoming the case. So being able to look at it and think about how we can change it or move away or make changes so it doesn't continue, because it will only grow, I think, over time. I can't see it really changing. So it's more how we live with that and keep the real human connections there at the same time.
And balance, you know, the balance. There's nothing wrong with getting information from screens. I'm no Luddite, but I do think we need to be aware of the imbalance of what we're getting fed.
Yes.
And the fact that you can't escape it, you know, whether it's in a, lying back in the dentist chair and there's a screen above you with the news on, you know, and you think, oh my goodness me. You know, it is everywhere. And as I said, the effect on us, we're starting to know now that, you know, have proof now that the effect on us is negative, and a lot of people sensed it, and that, you know, the response to the speech has been overwhelming. I think it did make people go, you know what, actually, yeah, I'm over it.
Yes, yeah, and it definitely hit a chord. Now, you are an absolute inspiration, a completely beautiful example of someone who does stay completely true to your values. And just quickly, I know we're out of time, but just quickly before we go, do you have any parting words of wisdom that you'd like to share with our listeners to encourage them on their journeys of parenthood?
Yeah. Courage. And connection, really. It's just so important to, even if your kids don't seem to want to talk to you, try and find something to do, you know, an activity or something that will just allow some sort of interaction. And keep reading to your kids and playing music, as you guys advocate so beautifully. You know, I read to my boys till they were 12, 13, and we loved that time together.
Yeah.
And they're still avid readers today, and that helps children on so many levels if they're read to and if they're given lots of things to absorb that are kind of positive. That's all I have to say.
Yeah, and well, beautifully said. Thank you so much for joining us on Little Rockers Radio today. I truly appreciate the time that you've taken out to chat to us. And
no worries, Sarah.
Thank you for your beautiful speech and for, I suppose, getting the discussion out there and starting to get people talking about all these different things. So thank you.
Yeah, my pleasure, my absolute pleasure. And you keep up the great work too.
Thank you. Now, there's a career highlight for me, interviewing the amazing Noni Hazelhurst on Little Rockers Radio. Thanks so much for listening.